Well, hello and a very good morning. Okay, so and a very good afternoon also and a very good evening based on the time in which you'll be watching this video. I know that the outside weather and the outside climate and the outside sky is very dull, boring. That is why I tried wearing something bright yellow so as to make your video brighter than the outside sky and also the outside climate. I'm hoping that everyone of you is doing well, doing fine, along with everyone in your families also is doing very good. And I'm hoping that you all are making use of this time. How you all are making use, I do not know, but I'm hoping that you all are making use of this time well, productively, and learning something new, doing something new every day, helping your parents, elders, brothers, sisters in some way or the other, and also doing things which, or learning things which you thought that it would be hard for you to learn or you would not have time to learn. So please keep on doing everything that you all are doing and keep on working hard. Okay, so in the previous lecture of standard 10, I think we were done with the Rajya Sabha, we were done with the Lok Sabha, we were done with the speaker, quorum, and the composition qualifications of members of Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha. Those were done. Now coming to the functionality part, what does the Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha, what do they actually do? When we are talking of the Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha, one thing is clear, that the Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha, they make laws and they'll be discussing on various laws, various different themes, various things which are happening in the country. If you all look at the proceedings of Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha in the television, in Lok Sabha TV or Rajya Sabha TV, you'll be finding that people are shouting and people are speaking, people are making laws, someone saying that please maintain the, or the speaker and the chairman saying please maintain the decorum of the house, okay, please do not say this, please do not say that, please give a chance to this person to speak. Those are the things which we all see. But what is actually the, or what are the things on which the parliament is making laws? When we talk of the parliament, you all know, there's the president, there's the Rajya Sabha and the Lok Sabha. It is said that the Lok Sabha has been given greater responsibility and greater lawmaking powers as compared to the Rajya Sabha. Can anyone tell me why? Okay, I hope that I would have liked someone to tell me why, but it won't be possible right now. Let me tell you why. It is because when the constitution makers of our country, when those freedom fighters, they were making the laws of our country, they understood one thing, that people had to fight a lot, people had to go through a lot so as to gain this independence, and it will be wrong so as to deprive the people of their independence and also to deprive the people of the lawmaking powers. Now, we cannot be asking, when India got independent, we were somewhere around 30 crore our population. Right now, we are standing at 130 crore. So, even in that time, even during our independence time, the lawmakers understood that, the constitution makers, they understood that asking 30 crore people to rule themselves, make laws for themselves, will be a chaos, will result in chaos. So that wasn't possible. So they thought about that instead of people making the laws directly, we are not a direct democracy. There are two kinds of democracies. One is direct democracy, one is indirect democracy. We are an indirect democracy. Indirect democracy means that we are, or the people are not making laws themselves, but the representatives of the people who are there in the parliament, they are making laws for the people. So we are indirectly related with the lawmaking process, not directly related to it. There are some places, some countries, or mainly in Switzerland, in a few cantons, that is a few states of Switzerland, you will be finding direct democracy is still in practice, but in other places it is mostly indirect democracy. We are also an indirect democracy. Now, while the lawmakers or the constitution makers were making the law or making the constitution of our country, they understood that giving more power to the Rajya Sabha or to the people who are not Rajya Sabha, as you all understood, the Rajya Sabha does not contain people who are directly elected by the people of our country. So the members of the Rajya Sabha are not directly elected by the members of our by the population of our country. So the lawmakers or the constitution makers, they understood that giving more power to the Rajya Sabha will be a bit undemocratic. It will not reflect the true democracy. It will not reflect, or it will not give the power to the people to make their own laws. So as to give more power to the people, so as to make their own laws, it was the Lok Sabha which was given greater power. You can also see one thing, that the numbers numbers in the Lok Sabha is far greater than that of the Rajya Sabha. It is nearly or more than double the number of members which is there in the Rajya Sabha. Members of Lok Sabha is 545, members of Rajya Sabha is 245. Why is it so? This is also because so as to shift the balance a bit towards the Lok Sabha side. Why? So that people, it is eventually the people who make or who are more or who have a more say or who is the more dominant, who plays the more dominant role over here in making laws than the Rajya Sabha. So Lok Sabha was given greater number, Lok Sabha was given greater power, but it also does not mean that the Rajya Sabha has no power. Rajya Sabha does have power when it comes to making laws on the state list. Rajya Sabha does have power, a few special powers. Those powers we'll be dealing with later on, but it is the Lok Sabha which is much more, or which has been given a greater power over here, or greater share of power in the lawmaking process than the Rajya Sabha. I will be happy if you all can, okay, this is a informal assignment which I am giving you all, as you all may be used to in class, those who, okay, in the classes which I was teaching. So I'm just giving an informal assignment. I'll be happy if you all can give me a written assignment, or you can give me a written message kind of a thing. You can email me, WhatsApp me, whatever it is. The reasons why you think that the Lok Sabha is having greater power in the lawmaking process than the Rajya Sabha, you have to give me detailed reasons. And there are reasons more than the two reasons which I gave. There will be a few other reasons also. So I'll be happy if anyone can give me those reasons in writing, in a kind of a, you do not have to make an assignment and write it in a paper. You can just type it out. But I'll be happy if someone can give me that. Now coming on to the lawmaking process. What are the legislative powers of the parliament? Now on what matters does the parliament make laws on? As I was telling, there are three lists. The union list, the state list and the concurrent list. Now the union list has a lot more subjects than the state list, and the concurrent list also has more subjects than the state list. What are the three different lists over here? The union list talks about, or union list contains subjects on which the union parliament will be able to make laws. The state list contains subjects on which the union parliament will not be making laws, but the state legislatures will be making laws, that is the Vidhan Sabhas. And the concurrent list contains subjects which are not mentioned in the state list nor in the union list. It is in the concurrent list, or those matters which are subjects which are there in the concurrent list, both the union and the state can make laws on the subjects which are there in the concurrent list. But there is one slight but over here. The slight but is that if suppose there is one subject A which is there under the concurrent list, and on that subject A, both the state has also a law and the union also has made a law. So it will be the union's law which will be prevailing, or which will be put to use or put to force, and not the state law. So over here we can see that the union is a bit more, or the lawmaking process is a bit more biased towards the union than towards the states. Another assignment, a short one. Very informal assignment it will be, and I will be requiring this, or if anyone is interested, please send it to me via electronic medium or electronic means. The assignment will be, or the question is, tell me ways by which, or what are the things, or what ways, or what are those things which makes you feel, or which makes it clear to you that the Indian legislature or the Indian constitution was a bit more biased towards the union legislature and not towards the state legislature. Or I'm reframing the question, it is a federal country. In a federal country there is equal division of power between the center and the states, but in our country it is said that our constitution is unitary in nature. Okay, it is this federation, I'm not telling that, this federation is a bit biased in our constitution. The federation is a bit biased towards the union and not towards the states. What are the reasons which make you think that the federation is a bit biased towards the union and not towards the state? Please submit it to me anytime you all want. Now moving on, the union parliament, the Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha, they'll be making laws then only on matters which are there in the union list, also at times on the matters which are there in the concurrent list. And there are a few residuary powers. What is the meaning of residuary powers? It means, what does the mean residue mean? And what does the word residue mean? Residue means leftovers. So the leftovers of, or the subjects which are not there in the three lists, neither in the union list, nor in the state list, and or in the concurrent list, there will be a few subjects which will not be there in either of the three lists. So those subjects are falling under the residue subjects. On those residue subjects or on that is the residuary power which is there with the union parliament. So the union parliament, that is the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, they can make laws on these residuary subjects also. Now moving on, what are, how or when does the parliament, or when is the parliament able to make laws on the state list? On the state list, if suppose we are in a time of national emergency, if during those emergency we can make, or the, not we, the union parliament can make laws on the state list. Also, if the Rajya Sabha, now why over here the Rajya Sabha is coming, I'll be coming to that later, but if the Rajya Sabha by two-third majority or passes by two-third majority that some subject in the state list is of national importance, then that subject or on that subject the union will be making a law and not the state. Why is the Rajya Sabha empowered to do this? Because it is the Rajya Sabha which is there, or which is known as the Council of the States, which looks after the welfare of the states and which also looks after the interests of the state. Now that is why it is only the Rajya Sabha which can make a law, or which can by majority say that okay, some law is important, some subject is important, so let not the states make a law on that, but let the union make a law on that. If this power would have been given to the Lok Sabha, then it would have been undemocratic, because the Lok Sabha is not representing the interest of the state. It is the Rajya Sabha which is representing the best interests of the state. So that is why this power has been given to the Rajya Sabha. And also when two or more states are requiring the parliament or the union parliament, Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, to make a law on certain subject which they think can be or is important and they are unable to make a law on that, then on those subjects the union legislature will be making a law. So I think it is clear now which are the times when the union can make laws on the state legislature. So by this also you can understand that the Indian constitution is a bit biased. Why? Because the union, the states cannot make a law on subjects which are there in the union list, but the union can at times, or during extraordinary times, by extraordinary measures, can make laws which are there, or on subjects which are there in the state list. And finally, for today, this will be the last topic which I'll be dealing with today. What are ordinances? Ordinances are nothing but they are legislative instruments which are issued by the president when the parliament is not in session. Before I move on, or before I say further, what are parliamentary sessions? Parliamentary sessions are periods during which the parliament meets, or both the houses and the members of the parliament, they meet, they come together to discuss and make laws. So there are different sessions in the of our parliament during a certain year. We have the budget session, we have the winter session, we have the monsoon session. So in between these sessions there is a gap, and in those gaps, or during those gap times, if suppose some new matter comes up or something comes up which requires a law to be made, so at that time we cannot be asking all the parliamentarians to come and join and then we'll be making a law. So what happens during those time is that the president does not act alone. The president, on the advice of the Council of Ministers, in the constitution it is mentioned that the president will be acting on the advice of the executive, or on the advice of the Council of Ministers and the Prime Minister. So we're here also, when the parliament is not in session, but a new or something important has come up on which a law is required, so the president, on the advice of the Council of Ministers and the Prime Minister, will be issuing or promulgating an ordinance. And this ordinance will be having the same power as that of a law which has been made by the Parliament of India. So this ordinance of the President, which the President is giving, this ordinance will be having the same power as that of the Act, or as that of an Act which is made by the Parliament. But this ordinance is not permanent. what happens is this ordinance will be in force, and after the parliament, they come together, after the parliament resumes its session or comes back and assembles together, and there's a session of the parliament will be voting on that, and the parliament will be discussing on that. So when the parliament is resuming its session, or when the parliament comes back, the parliament will be debating, voting on that ordinance which had been promulgated by the president. If the parliament so thinks that the ordinance should be scrapped or removed and a new law will be made, or the ordinance is no more required to be in place now, then the parliament can, by voting, remove the ordinance. The parliament can also give the force of or give the ordinance or make the ordinance an act, and that ordinance will become an act and will be a law for the entire country, will be a permanent law. And also the parliament can do nothing. Yes, it can do nothing. It won't do nothing. And if it does not do anything on that ordinance, what happens is that the ordinance, after the parliament meets, the ordinance will automatically lapse after 6 weeks. So the ordinance will be losing its power after 6 weeks, and ordinance will not be will not be having any force after 6 weeks, or 6 weeks after the parliament meets, or the parliament is in session. So I think this ordinance part was clear to you all. So ordinance is nothing but an extraordinary force or extraordinary law which is promulgated by the president when the parliament is not in session, and the president does so on the advice of the aided and advised by the prime minister and the council of ministers. I am hoping that till this point everything was clear, and if there were any doubts, please tell it to me in the comment section. And also remember about the 2 assignments I gave. Please stay productive, keep on studying, and keep on enjoying.